Good afternoon and welcome to St. Paul's here in Key West, Florida. Before we start our program, since we'll be talking a lot about the organ today and hearing it as well, I thought we'd take a walk around the sanctuary, the nave, so that you can see a little bit about what we're discussing. So here we go. Here's part of the pipes that are the facade pipes. The purple pipes are the newest to be moved here. We'll discuss them in a minute. Up here above the organ console are the chimes. We'll talk about them. This is the Mary Chapel and a flute. We'll talk about that. On this side is the Great Division. These pipes are not in a box, are not expressed, and a lot of the pipe work is behind these grids here, but this is the Great Division. And then new to St. Paul's, while we have been all on lockdown, we've been under contract for some time to replace the chests that were back here, and we'll talk about them. So this is the gallery organ by the Jesse Tree window. And these are all the principal pipes. You can see some pipes in the background as well. And then on this side are some flutes, the mixture, the sesquialtera, the dulciana. We'll talk about them. So when we make reference to them, you know what we're looking at. And good afternoon and welcome to Performance at St. Paul's, here from St. Paul's in Key West, Florida. Today is my third session at the organ, and I thought appropriate to tell you about the instrument. But first, I would like to play a piece for you by Eric Tina. He was an organist, conductor, and composer in England who lived from 1900 to 1975. He was a fellow of the Royal College of Organists and received a Doctor of Music there in 1928. Well known for solo voice and choral works, Tiemann also composed extensively for the organ. Here is one little gem called Canzona. This piece features the clarinet stop on the organ. Thank you. organ here originally was installed in 1932 by the Frazee Organ Company of Massachusetts. It was installed in the west chamber behind the military chapel, behind heavy curtains, speaking into that west transept, and mostly through the choir division here. It contained 14 ranks of pipes. The console resided in a pit below the current console, right here. It had two manuals. It was made of mahogany. By the early 1970s, there were many years of water damage to contend with, and much of the organ was not playable. The water had damaged the leather pouches and valves under each pipe. Many of them need to be replaced. The organ had to be playable for weddings and Sundays, so much of the organ was re-leathered a few notes at a time. The original swell 8-foot English horn was in such bad shape that it had to be removed and the wind blocked off. Who knows what happened to so many of those pipes since then? Much of the organ pipe chests were spared from termite damage, however, since they had been treated with chromated copper arsenate. With fervent work, by the mid-70s, the organ was fully playable and in reasonably good tune for the first time in many years. There were a few ranks of pipes that were added at that time, as well as wiring work, allowing the organ to be more versatile. Through the late 80s and the early 90s, much pipe work was added, as well as moving divisional chests and extensions within the chamber. At that time, the festival trumpet and the vault flute above the Mary Chapel that we saw were added, along with the antiphonal organ of just four ranks at the rear of the church, as well as the new grade division in the chamber. During this time, the original console was replaced with a four-manual chanse console that you see here today. I actually have reason to believe that there was a three-manual console here for a little while. I've seen a picture, but I cannot find anything written about it. Approximately 12 years ago, there was a complete re-leathering of the original Frazee wind chests, replicating of termite damage components, reconfiguring the switching systems, replacing of the wind chest, and restoration of many of the pipes, as well as adding a new oboe in the swell. In recent years, much of the winding issue were cared for, new winding for the chests, some re-leathering of some of the reservoirs, and just the stabilizing of the wind system. Within the last 4 years, there has been an aggressive push to get the organ once again in good shape. The power supply, or the rectifier, which converts AC to DC at the organ console was replaced. Sets of pipes were rewired because of salt water damage to the wires. Tremolos were added to the swell and choir division. Three ranks of pipes were rebuilt and revoiced: the choir chimney flute, the swell gedeckt, and the great flute d'amour. Two more ranks of pipes were installed: the choir 4-foot Geigen octave, and the great 4-foot principal. New custom chests were built and installed under the pedal division 16-foot open wood pipes. These pipes had not been played for over 20 years because of water and termite damage to the chests. They couldn't hold air. Also, the 16-foot Gemshorn was rewinded so that the wind pressure could be regulated. Last year, the bottom octave of the 16-foot Gedeckt was moved. They had been buried at the far end of the chamber, and although playable, they really could hardly be heard. 8 of these pipes have become part of the facade pipes above where the choir sings. We saw them painted purple. They have been painted that royal purple to match all the other wooden pipes that you see throughout the church. Why the royal purple, you may ask? The answer seems to be as simple as looking at the Jesse tree window at the rear of the nave. There are a lot of grapes in all the panes that are purple. So it's just a compliment, which is already here in the church. Last summer, the blower motor for the main organ was replaced. As the organ grew, The old blower could not provide enough air, and a new blower motor was needed. The blower room was all cleaned, all the walls freshly painted, and the new blower was installed shortly after. Last fall, we replaced the chimes and have a completely new action so that they all work. This was done also by a very generous donation from a member of the church. In the last month and a half, we have completely replaced the chests and added additional 9 ranks of pipes in the gallery at the rear of the church. These chests, made of Brazilian mahogany, were donated by Gazowski and Steps organ builders, who have maintained our organ for many years. The previous chests were installed in the 90s, made of plywood, and had become very unreliable since they had so much termite damage. The division now includes a separate principal at 8-foot, 4-foot, and 2-foot, a war flute, 8-foot, a vault flute, or wood flute, at 4-foot, a dulcian and celeste, a 2-rank sesquialtera, and a 4-rank mixture. This next piece that I would like to play for you features the gallery organ. Fuga in F major, composed by James Neves, who lived from 1715 to 1783. Well known for his choral works, he also composed for harpsichord and organ. He was assistant organist at St. George Chapel in Windsor, and eventually he returned to Chapel Royal in 1756 to become organist and composer to George III. The English organs were basically taken out of the churches during the English Reformation of the 16th century and the Commonwealth period. They oftentimes were relocated into private homes. Then from 1660 to 1685, known as the Restoration period, organ builders brought in new ideas of organ building from continental Europe. The English organ evolved from basically small 1 or 2 manual instruments with no pedal board. The swell box and the independent pedal division appeared in England not until the 18th century. I've added just a little bit of pedal work for this piece, James Nair's Fuga in F Major.
Thank you.
is just a suggestion of an echo in that piece. So let's delve into this a little deeper and listen to this brillante section of Robert Roderick's Voluntary in F Major, circa 1800. Roderick was the organist at Wells Cathedral. He lived in Bristol his entire life. Listen carefully. Can you hear the echo? Presently, the organ is at 46 ranks, playable from three manuals of the four-manual console that you see here. The top manual of the organ is reserved for the chimes. There are still more ranks of pipes not playable, and many pipes have been stolen or just thrown away. We are currently in the process of developing a plan to make some more repairs and improvements so that this organ, the king of the instruments, one of the southernmost pipe organs in America, can continue to sing God's praises in this church. My final piece for you today brings the whole organ all together with trumpets, principal chorus, and mixtures, here with the tune Crucifer, or Lift High the Cross, set by John Eckert, emeritus professor of music at Concordia University, St. Paul, where he taught organ, music theory, and composition. you for joining us today. It means a lot. If you find it in your heart and you would like to donate to the Organ Fund, please send a check to St. Paul's Episcopal Church, 401 Duval Street, Key West, Florida, 33040. Please make a note of it in the memo that it is for the Organ Fund. We are always raising monies to care for this instrument, and it is through gifts like yours that it is still playing today. Next week, we will all be engineers and hope to learn just a little on how the modern pipe organ works. We will use the organ at St. Paul's as our organ of demonstration. We hope also to sing some hymns together. So please, in your responses here on Facebook, tell me what hymns you would like to hear. I will see if we can fit them in.